Welcome back to In the Studio with Kevin Savage, a podcast for producers. You are watching or listening to part one of our mini-series on music distribution, the past, the present, and the future. We very briefly talked about the history of music distribution, and we went ahead and laid some foundation and drew some lines at where this podcast is going to start and what we're looking at. Now, I think we're also trying to really put everything into perspective. I often find it really easy to kind of think about history on a theoretical perspective, basis, where it's not really kind of grounded and brought down to earth, and just kind of like the reality of how long a year is, how long 10 years is. Now, I think that is really important, especially with this exponential growth. And so, you know, that's why I really thought it was important to kind of lay out, hey, this is the history of music distribution, and this is how many years between these major changes and evolutions were. You know, I think that this is particularly important when we think about distribution in the present sense, as both the value of music to the consumer and as the way the artists think about their career changes. But we will get into that in like a later episode, as we have more than enough to discuss here. Now, it has been the norm up until probably the late 70s or so, perhaps a little earlier, maybe late 60s, early 70s, that artists to distribute their music required the backing of a label or some sort of entity that could invest in the artist and provide the necessary capital to bring the artist into a studio, pay for all the recording fees, then pay for the production costs, and finally get the art into the hands of the consumer. These individuals are what I like to call part of the gatekeeper class. Now, gatekeepers exist in many mediums, from critics to companies that own the airwaves to label executives. There were some artists now, of course, finding DIY solutions, often in the punk scenes. But any artist that wanted even moderate success needed to be essentially approved by these gatekeepers, much like making a movie in the 20th and early 21st centuries. It was incredibly expensive and required access granted by the gatekeepers. So has music. Now, things have changed since then, obviously, and we will touch on that in the next part when we look at the present. But let's continue to discuss the gatekeepers and this history of distribution. Now, gatekeepers, like any CEO or executive who has board members and a business to run, requires a return on investment, and is inherently, and this inherently means taking strategically low negative consequence risks, if risks are really even taken at all. Now, there are perhaps some gatekeepers who have thought outside the box and invested in high-risk projects because they have a gut feeling, and despite all the signs that they shouldn't take the opportunity, they go ahead and take the opportunity. But more often than not, this is not the case. This also means that certain classes, races, etc., float to the top, and others either sink to the bottom or just kind of stagnate. I mean, we honestly can't forget that all of the 20th century and all the centuries prior were plagued with this, you know, dark looming cloud of Jim Crow and redlining and slavery and all the nasty bigotry that comes along with it. And while that absolutely still exists today, it has been considerably more flushed out. Now, this means that in the history of music distribution, especially throughout the 20th century and prior, folks like Elvis Presley and Johnny Cash are going to be prioritized as more marketable over black and brown artists who have equal or even greater talent. White executives, gatekeepers, are obviously going to prioritize white artists and market it as mainstream, whereas black artists are kept in the shadows. And this has happened quite a bit, and luckily, as the music distribution industry evolves and things change. That's changed, but even in looking at the history of the Oscars or history of the Emmys or the Grammys or any of these other award platforms, the people who historically get promoted and are the most successful are not Black and brown people. Now, I remember having a conversation with a friend who believed that Gatekeepers were a good thing because it brings back integrity to a world where anyone can publish a piece of news or book or song. He demonized mumble rap and the overall aesthetic surrounding it, which perhaps you don't like it as well. But nevertheless, it's part of an important evolution of music and attributes like texture, timbre, and some of the lesser but equally important qualities. Those are left out of the discussion, prioritizing harmony, melody, and rhythm, a very honestly simplistic and Eurocentric view of music and analysis of music. Take that, Ben Shapiro. Now, as we see the evolution of music distribution from gramophones to streaming services, we equally see the slow deconstruction of these gatekeepers. In some cases, we see them take shelter in other aspects of the industry. But while they were at one point sitting high and allowing what deemed worthy to cross the threshold, it no longer really exists. And this is honestly truly beautiful. DIY is no longer niche. It is no longer only in the underground. It is no longer found in a bin in a corner of a record store. And that leaves me with a final point, and maybe controversial point. Who do we thank for this? The persistence of artists, maybe. The internet, definitely. Social media, to some extent. I mean, I believe that it is honestly the pirates, the BitTorrent sites, the Napster, etc., and the big tech companies like Apple, Samsung, Google, etc. Without the people demanding a change, any music at your fingertips, full artist catalog, niche artist discography, etc., and the tech companies approaching business from a place of adaption and innovation, we may not be where we are at today. I remember the days when I had to select which CDs I wanted to carry around with me. During the day, I had to pick and choose between Good Charlotte and Blink-182. And if I didn't like it and I was out and about and didn't have a way of getting home immediately, tough luck. I had to listen to it. I had to sit through it. Now as we shifted from CDs to MP3s, things got better, of course. I had a lot more choices. But now, honestly, now that we've shifted away from just downloading MP3s and we've shifted to streaming music, it is infinite music available at our fingertips at any point in time, as long as you have a Wi-Fi connection. And then when you don't have a Wi-Fi connection or a data connection, you feel like you're back in the 90s, even though like the reality of having millions of songs on hand is just insane. I also the fact that these platforms allow other people to create playlists, which you then share. You learn and you're introduced to new music, whether it's through business, like the companies curating the playlists, or some other person who you know, or you search and you find someone's playlist, to even these algorithms that determine, oh, these are what you listen to, and these are some new music, and these might interest you, etc. It's the possibilities are endless, and it's just insane to think about. Now, we all have to keep in mind as we enter into the present and look into the future that the gatekeepers, they didn't want this. They were absolutely fine with selling albums rather than songs. They were absolutely fine with things being the way they are because that's how they make their money. They maximize they maximize the cost, they, you know, they reduce the costs and figure out the cheapest way of maximizing their profit in a particular medium. And as things are changing, you know, that requires them to spend money and invest in the change. They didn't want the democratization. They, because ultimately they don't have power over it, and adapt or die is their only option. But for people, this new world, the present, is honestly a beautiful place. And that's why I've wanted to talk about this history of music distribution from the past to the present, and then, you know, kind of brainstorming and looking at the future. Now, we'll be right back for some final thoughts and whatnot. And I just want to say, you know, thank you for listening. I hope that this has been educational, and I hope that you will dive a little deeper into the history too. So we'll be right back, okay?